Welcome to Touring with the Candidates, brought to you by the Santa Barbara League of Women Voters Education Fund. Each of the candidates for Santa Barbara City Council will have up to 10 minutes to take you on his or her tour of the city. The itinerary and commentary included is up to each candidate. The program is filmed and produced by Larry Nimmer. Let's take a look.
Well, hi.
Hi there.
And you are?
I'm Jerry Mateo, and I'm running for City Council.
Well, nice to see you today.
Thank you. Welcome to my segment of Touring Santa Barbara. Let's go for a bike ride.
Okay.
Come and join me for the ride.
Okay.
Well, the purpose for me running for City Council is to support a conscious change in how our community is developed. I want to support the people at large to take a more active role in shaping the way their lives are here in Santa Barbara. If you look at an organizational chart of the city, you'll see that above the mayor and the city council and all the departments below, everybody has their responsibility. But above all is the electorate. That's the people of this community. It's your ultimate responsibility to let everybody know in the department what you need in the community. And if you don't take an active role, people are just going to do the best they know how to get things done here. And how do you take a more active role? It's very simple. Just go around your community. Take a look at what works and what doesn't work and give your feedback. That's the most important thing you could do. And it really helps shape the way things are done in this town. For example, are bulb outs really in our best interest? For example, is it really necessary to put a huge bulb out in front of the whole length of the Victoria Theater?
Go ahead.
And is spending $50 million on a new police station a financial obligation that you're really prepared to take on? And also let a lot of other projects take a back seat to? These are things you really need to take a good, hard consideration of. It's your responsibility. These are the choices you're making. Okay.
Hey there, Jerry.
Hi there again. So taking an active role in the community may seem to be an overwhelming task for a lot of folks out there. But I want to assure you that there's a lot one person can do. You know, for the last 5 years, I've been greeting people on the sidewalks of Santa Barbara right here in front of the mall, giving out free hugs as part of the Global Free Hugs Movement. And the purpose is to encourage people to get together in a sense of community and supporting each other and not being afraid to communicate with strangers and get to know your neighbor. When you unify yourselves together as a community, you can do a lot to restore the integrity of the homes that you live in and your community at large. So let's go take a ride to the beach. So for a person like myself who loves to bike in Santa Barbara provides some of the nicest bike trails and paths that a person could ask for. And still, there are a few areas that could use some improvement. Come on, I'll show you where they are. I'm here right now at the end of the bike path by the Bird Refuge. This is one area that's in dire need of repair. It's pretty hazardous in some spots, and I've actually seen people get seriously injured here. And also, at the end of this bike path is an intersection where there is insufficient crosswalks and signage. It'll be a simple fix, so it makes it safer for bikers as well as pedestrians to cross the street here. So here's the second most important, the second of two most important areas where we could use some improvement for bicycle safety on our streets in Santa Barbara. This is our famous Coast Village Road Hot Springs Roundabout. There really isn't enough bicycle-friendly space for bikers to ride. You have to beat a vehicle in the road and share with the cars. This problem can be easily fixed just by painting some road sharing bicycle chevron signs on the road and put some signage up that says yield for bikers and pedestrians. So it's time to move on. So thank you for joining me on this brief tour of our beautiful city here in Santa Barbara. My vision for Santa Barbara is to inspire a cooperative, earth-conscious lifestyle by maintaining a balanced and measured growth, which is both green and self-sustainable. I believe that by shifting our attitudes of consumerism, competition, and conflict to attitudes of conservation, cooperation, and compassion, we can co-create our harmonious and prosperous community. So there you have it. That's my vision for this community. And I can't do it without your support. Let's work together on doing this for Santa Barbara. Let's get together on doing this for you. Help get me on the city council, and together we can create the community that works for all of us.
Okay, well, good luck, Jerry.
Thank you.
You are watching Touring with the Candidates, brought to you by the League of Women Voters of Santa Barbara. Let's look at the next candidate.
Well, hi there. And you are?
I am Sharon Byrne, and I'm running for city council.
Okay, well, let's go.
All right, let's go. So, Larry, we're in my West Downtown neighborhood. And one of the reasons I wanted to bring you here is that Sharon the candidate would never have been born if I hadn't moved to this neighborhood. That sometimes in life, there are circumstances and collisions and occurrences that change your whole path. And this was one for me. I moved here in December of 2008, and I knew it was a bit rough. I knew that I needed to invest in a dog and possibly a weapon.
What part of town are we in?
We're in West Downtown, which is two blocks west of State Street, below Carrillo Street. We're on Delavina, right at Haley. This is where I live. I went out on a really bad date in February, shortly after I moved here. I got home early, and right where we're walking now, a boy that had been in my neighborhood for two days, his name was Bartolomeo Leal, he's 22, he was murdered by six people on this street. And we didn't know it, and no one realized that he was murdered, because what we were used to in this neighborhood is a lot of bar traffic, a lot of drunks, and we would find people sort of laying in our bushes or laying in our yards on a fairly regular basis. So to see a young man laying in the grass was not that unusual to us, or laying on the ground. The problem was that he was a stabbing victim. And when we woke up the next morning, we were behind police tape, and he had died here. And this is right where he fell. He traveled roughly a block north and fell here. And he laid here all night. There was no street light here. It was a pool of darkness. And none of the people passing through realized there was a young man bleeding to death. That woke us up. That was sort of the last of three violent incidences that all happened within this one block radius in a span of about 3 months. There'd been another murder on Haley and a shooting on my corner. And that was the end. The women in the neighborhood woke up. We all looked at each other and said, that's it. No one can live like this. No one can live in this much fear. So we put together the West Downtown Neighborhood March. It was done February of 2009. We invited all the people running for mayor to come. And they came, and it was great. We had about 250 people, and it gelled and united the neighborhood. And we said, as our cry, we are West Downtown. What do we want? Safety now. Because of that march and the things that followed it, the whole neighborhood has changed. And now I think it's one of the best neighborhoods in downtown. So come on, I'll show you some more about it. All right, so here we are at the Haley-Delavina Bridge, which used to be one of the darkest and most dangerous corners in all of Santa Barbara. And now you can look at it and see, after construction, it opened in April of this year, that we have street lights now. Mayor Helene Schneider helped us with those. The bridge is much nicer. There's more open space for pedestrians. It's not nearly as dangerous as it used to be. And it helped take this little neighborhood from blight to bright. This is the bottom of Mission Creek as it feeds out. This is one of the last stops it makes on the way to the ocean. And now this is a total neighborhood feature, and you can see that capital improvement programs can do a lot to improve safety. So now we're in the Brinkerhoff Historic District. This is my friend Tony and Caroline's house, great neighbors. And Brinkerhoff is a historic jewel in the heart of West Downtown. They were also some of the most active and organized neighbors in helping us take back this neighborhood. This is a preservation district. It's very special, it's very precious, and I'm very happy that it's here. So let's go look at the next stop. All right, Larry, now we're in a little bit of a different part of West Downtown. We're at the corner of Chapala and Haley. And the story here is about zoning and how zoning can help or hurt a neighborhood. In this beautiful building right here, the Alchemy Arts Center, which is a gorgeous cafe and spa, this was actually going to be a marijuana dispensary 2 years ago. And the neighborhood organized together and decided to stop that from happening. And actually, I'm really happy that we did that. It was a lot of effort, it was a lot of work, but look at the business that opened here now and how good it is for the neighborhood. Next door to it is Adama, a really awesome vegan restaurant. Across the street is the Salvation Army Hospitality House, one of our best neighbors. They always let us use their facilities for meetings, and they're very helpful to us. And then right next to them is a new body shop that just opened, Happy's. So here you have in one little block what could have continued on as a very crime-infested, very run-down neighborhood. Now you see, come on, please come. Now you see new businesses opening, and you see people walking the streets, and you see that there's a lot of life here. And I'm very happy that this is the way it worked out. I learned something from this, and that is if you have a safe, clean, healthy neighborhood, businesses can open and they can thrive. That's important. All right, now we're driving over to Milpas, and you're riding in the mommy car. I have a 14-year-old daughter who has just started Santa Barbara High School, and she's way too old for terms like mommy, but there you go. But we're on our way to my job.
See, there's what's going on?
I'll say the fire truck just passed us. We're at the corner of Milpas and Haley. This is a very common occurrence on Milpas Street. We tend to be a high user of police and fire services here. And I'm going to tell you why in just a second. All right, Larry. Now we're in my office. Welcome to Milpas Street. This is where I work. I'm the executive director of the Milpas Community Association, and some of the work that I did in West Downtown, we're trying to replicate over here on the east side. We're at El Bajio. It's the best taqueria on Milpas Street. We got to go in and do a little work. So come on in with me.
You have something with you there, right?
I do. I have a thank you letter for a cleanup that we did this weekend. They donated. All right, this is Alicia, one of the owners of El Bajio. Alicia, I just want to thank you on behalf of the MCA for donating the tortas and the burritos to the cleanup this weekend. I think you saw it's a raging success. We had over 50 people and you helped feed all the volunteers. So I just want to say thank you on behalf of the MCA.
You're very welcome. We love our neighborhood, so anything to help.
Thanks, Alicia.
Thank you.
See you later. All right, we're going to go to the next place.
Okay, we're rolling again.
All right, we're rolling down Milpas Street under the 101 bridge. This bridge has been under construction for a year and a half. It finishes mid-2012. I've worked with a lot of the businesses on Milpas Street to clean up various street corners, deal with crime problems that they're having. The street faces two major problems. On the south end of the street, there's a large homeless population, and while certainly a great many of them don't cause us any problems, a small percentage do. And that tends to be problematic for the businesses and the property owners down here. On the north end of the street, there's more gang and youth violence and littering. And that tends to be the issue up there that we have to sort of work on. So we have two different focuses. All right, so Larry, we're here at Cabrillo Ballfield, one of the most beautiful pieces of real estate in Santa Barbara, right here at the ocean. And this is a particular success story for this little neighborhood, even though I'm picking up trash as we speak. In that it used to be a place where there was an awful lot of drug dealing and prostitution, and it was very hard to play baseball games here or have family events here. Now these fences that you see behind me around the dugouts, they went up in January. I was serving on the Franklin Advisory Committee when that happened, and we advocated for those fences to be here. And today, the ballpark is now used by families, by people in Santa Barbara. You see games here in the afternoon, soccer matches. That's the way it should be. I'm pretty happy about that. I'm not happy about the litter, though. I'm going to work on picking that up, and then we're going to the Cold Spring.
Okay.
Our final stop on this little tour is the Cold Spring. This is the place that I come to recharge and regenerate. We're in the heart of nature. We're surrounded by forest. We have beautiful, running, clean water. For me, it's a treasure of the environment. And the best thing about it is it's minutes away from the downtown core that we spent the morning in. I hope that you've enjoyed this tour with me. I hope that you've gotten a chance to see the issues that I work on, the people that I work with, the fact that I understand how you can create prosperity for businesses and neighborhoods tied to clean, safe, healthy neighborhoods, how it makes it better for families, for children, for all of us that live and work here. And I hope I can get your vote on November 8th. And I want to thank you for coming with me.
Okay, well, good luck to you, Sharon.
Thanks, Larry.
You're watching Touring with the Candidates for Santa Barbara City Council. I'm the film producer, Larry Nimmer. Let's watch the next candidate. Well, hello there.
Hello there.
And you are?
I'm Michael Self, and I'm running for re-election, and it's good to see you again, Larry.
Nice to see you. Well?
Well, I have something new to show you, my Christmas present, which is this doorbell gong.
Oh, is she, how does it work? Very nice. I like that.
A house built in 1910, they didn't do doorbells then, so this was what we did.
I like it with the softball. Huh?
Yeah, well, we're trying to figure out how to make it more attractive.
Okay.
Come on in.
Okay. You have a lovely home here.
Thank you. What I thought I'd show you because is our refrigerator with a glass door, because that was the thing that got most comments from people last time you were here. So come on.
Let's take a look again. All right, there it is. That's something.
People ask me if I feel I have to tidy it up, and I figure, well, it's food. What do? You eat it.
Okay, well.
Well, I thought we would go to Alice Keck Park.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, thank you. Larry, on the way, I promised Blair I'd bring him a sign, so thank you.
Thank you. We're honored.
Okay, here we are. Planting a sign in the Eugenia.
Eugenia's good for something.
And Michael, where are we now?
Right now we're on the Upper East Side. And one of the concerns that this neighborhood has, and I think it's a valid one, is lessening the standards for granny units, which would in essence make this area an R2 area instead of an R1. R1 is a single family residence, and where is the police when you need them? That's been
a complaint. Speeding,
yes, yeah. Yes. That's why we're getting more of them. Yes, we have more. And anyway, granny units would in essence change the character of this, because what planning staff wants to do, they want to allow anybody to put a second unit and not have off-street parking. And as you can see, there are hardly any cars parked here because the standards were maintained for a very beautiful and livable community. So this is one thing that we're going to be wending through the ordinance committees, and so we hope you come out and speak your piece.
And I hope what you say is going to come true.
Yes, okay. We're going to work at
good.
It.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Bye. Well, Larry, we just witnessed one of the biggest griefs in Santa Barbara, and that is people speeding. And I have been saying from the beginning, why are people speeding? And I think it's a couple of things. Our cars perform better. But the other thing, from the 60s and 70s, where everybody is talking about their rights, they've really forgotten the other R word, which is responsibility, and another even bigger R word, which is respect. And so without respect for your and responsibility for your behavior in a community, it negatively impacts everybody. And I have been a strong advocate for increasing our police force. And that's what we've done. And we've been losing officers for the past decade. And now for the first time, because we've been careful how we're spending our money, is that we've been able to add to the police force. And I think that every neighborhood should be patrolled by a traffic officer. So we don't have that kind of behavior here. It's unacceptable. Here we are at Alice Keck Memorial Gardens. And to me, this park represents community activity. This property was scheduled to be 2 9-story, over 100-foot tall buildings. And because of the community activity and Pearl Chase got involved, this is now a memorial garden. And to me, I think this is emblematic of what Santa Barbara wants for its community. We can't be all parks. We do need housing, and I recognize that. But it needs to be in a Santa Barbara style. And to me, Santa Barbara style, if you look around, it's open and it's breathable. And the architect who worked with Pearl Chase, the reason our houses are at a 45-degree angle to the sun rising and setting is so that all sides of our house would have the warmth of the sun. And a lot of people don't know that, and that's okay, but it's just, it was for health, it was for openness. And so when we end up with what happened on Chapala, which one of our previous council members said was an experiment, that made me really angry because I don't think...
You mean the tall building?
Right? Yeah, the tall buildings, you know, and it's just one concrete block after another. And so this is our city staff telling developers what they must build to how we should live, where Santa Barbara is world-renowned because of how we have built in the past. And I think Pearl Chase was very forward-thinking. And so some people are trying to say that we're not modern enough. Well, it's tried, it's true, and we don't want to be just any old city on the coast. If you want that, you can go there. But this is Santa Barbara, and I think it's worth protecting. I think there are only two things that will make Santa Barbara less expensive. The first one we're witnessing now with this big downturn in the economy. People over the past very few years have lost about half their housing value. The only other thing we can do to reduce housing costs is to destroy what Santa Barbara is. I think that's too high a price to pay. Well, here we are at the other end of the pond at Alice Keck Park Memorial Gardens. And here, you know, we're such a wonderful community. We have the ocean, we have the hillsides with our beautiful homes. At night, it looks, you know, bedecked with lights. It's beautiful. And for those of you who are watching, I hope you noticed, and you probably are watching if you're watching this, but we just passed the Plan Santa Barbara, pretty much. There's more steps to go. But once the plan is finally adopted by council, then the real work begins, because that work involves our ordinance committees, because everything in the general plan needs to have a resolution of an ordinance, and the devil is in the details. So that's what I hope to be working on again in your behalf, because I don't think our city should fundamentally change. We need to grow, we will grow, but that growth needs to be in a measured, considered, thoughtful way, because we only have so much room in this city and not everybody can live here. I recognize that. I hope you do too. So we want to go forward without destroying what Santa Barbara is. And so that's going to be our task at council, to implement these things in a way that the community wants, because we're representatives. Yes, we all have opinions. We're trying to let you know what those opinions are so you can make your choice, because you do have a varied choice this year. So watch everybody, listen to what they're saying. I hope you vote for me. I love this city and my door is always open. So whatever your concerns are, call me. And I'm listed in the phone book too. So I hope to hear from you because this is our home and it's worth protecting and preserving from overdevelopment. I don't want to see anybody capitalize on what this city is. It's our home.
Okay, well, good luck to you then, Michael.
Thank you, Larry. I appreciate it. It's going to be an exciting season, and I'm looking forward to it. We're having forums all the time, so come out and see what we're all about. Thank you, Larry.
You are watching Touring with the Candidates for Santa Barbara City Council. Let's look at the next candidate.
Hey, how are you doing?
Hi, and you are?
I'm Randy Rouse.
And you're running for Santa Barbara City?
I'm running for Santa Barbara City Council. I happen to be a council member currently, but I'm running for election this coming November.
And where are we?
We're at the Paradise Cafe, and this is what I do when I'm not at City Council. I have the Paradise Cafe, and I've had it since 1983.
And the location?
We're on the corner of Anacap and Ortega, right? The heart of downtown and right across from City Hall, interestingly enough.
And why are you part of this whole City Hall thing?
Well, that's pretty interesting, Larry. I have been a community activist for a long time. I've been involved in a lot of civic commissions and committees, done budgets, and I've wagged my finger at former councils for a long time about issues in the downtown. So when the opportunity came up and Doss Williams moved off to Assembly, I put my name in the hat, and myself and 46 others vied for this seat that I was appointed to last December. And I think we've done some good things. I think council's headed in a good direction. I think we're a pretty collegial group that can work towards betterment of Santa Barbara, probably in a more cohesive way than it's been happening in a long, long time. So now that we've got it going, I think we should keep going, and that's why I'm running again. I'm running again because I think we have some good momentum, and I think there's good things that are being done, and to stop now would be a bit of a shame.
Now, being a restaurateur, do you feel like you have a pulse of the people, or do you hear issues? And
every day is a town hall here at the Paradise Cafe. I do get to talk to a lot of folks. People talk to me as, you know, Randy Rouse, business owner, or Randy Rouse, council member, but mostly as business owner, and being downtown, being a fixture downtown for a lot of years. So I get to hear a lot about what people think and how they feel about the downtown, about the trends of the downtown, whether they think it's clean or safe or being properly planned or traffic issues. And I get to hear it in an unfiltered way. Not everybody wants to come to council or have an appointment with a council member, but if they come in here, they can have a burger and ask those things at the same time. So it kind of works out for folks.
And what would you say are some of the more pressing issues now?
Right now, everybody's got their eyes and their ears on public safety and about cleanliness. Obviously, you know, we talk about money all the time. I don't think that's ever not been on the tips of people's tongues. But part of the economic issues downtown have to do with our cleanliness and our perception of safety. And we're working on increasing our uniform presence downtown, increasing the security. Being able to reinvite the people that live downtown or that live in the Santa Barbara back to the downtown. We still have a really strong tourist base. It's been a fantastic summer. But the folks downtown still feel like it needs some improvement, so that's what we're working on.
Is it both the homeless people and the gang situation?
Yeah, a little bit of both. I mean, it's, and it's not so much just, you know, when you say homeless, that covers a real broad base. There's just a lot of folks that are going through town on a transient level, some folks that really need services and help, some folks that really, frankly, don't. People that are either down on the luck or coming through town to get a few bucks to keep on going to the next destination, whatever it is, there have been some behaviors that are not acceptable. And it's the behaviors, not the people, but it's the behaviors themselves we're looking to change. And that has to do with presence. You have folks downtown that look like they're in charge. Chances are those behaviors start to go away, and I think that's been the case in the past, and it'll be the case very soon again in the future.
Okay, well, are we going to go out and get another perspective of town?
I think we should. I mean, you know, this is obviously a very cool little place, but there's other parts of town we should go look at.
Okay, I'll follow you.
Okay, thanks. Come on out. Well, Larry, I thought I'd bring you down to my other office. This is where I get my real work done.
Okay, let's check it out. Wow, it's great out here.
Yeah, and we're coming to my favorite part, which is where we get to turn off the engine. And now we're officially a sailboat there, Larry. And what's great about this for me, this is a great escape. This is a part of Santa Barbara you don't normally get to see. You don't get to see from land, obviously, but an angle that you see sometimes in calendars, or if you're lucky enough to go out on a condor and go whale watching along those lines. But these mountains up and down the coast, this represents such a unique part of the California coastline. We are an east-west running coastline, so we're actually sailing pretty close to southeast right now. So the coastline running east and west gives us a southeast perspective on. So if you thought, how do we go to Catalina from here? Well, actually, where we go to Catalina from here is kind of where we're heading right now. And you can't see the islands today. There's a little bit of low clouds out there, but we're shooting right between the gap between Santa Cruz and Anacapa now as we speak. So almost on a dead end line for Santa Barbara Island and eventually the west end of Catalina. But anyway, so if you look at Santa Barbara, what an amazing coastline we have. You look way down there, you can see the Coral Casino in Biltmore. If you pan back all the way through the city towards the other way, you get over to Ledbetter Point, and you see the end of the breakwater. And this part of Santa Barbara, I just obviously can't get tired of. This combines the best of all worlds. You've got this amazing Riviera, and this vista compares to anywhere you'd find in the Mediterranean. As a matter of fact, a lot of people come from the Mediterranean to visit us, and a lot of our original settlers, some Italian, Spanish, and Basque families, came from those parts of the Mediterranean to be here, and this is kind of what most reminded them home. So, and of course, out here you're around the natural environment as well. Sailed over to the islands a couple of weeks ago and got stuck in a big pot of blue whales. Oftentimes you'll see humpbacks out there feeding, and two times a year you can see the gray whales migrating. So that's always incredible. You've got an amazing fishery here, really healthy kelp beds. Sometimes folks are going, well, there's an awful lot of kelp on the beach, and why don't you clean up the beach? Well, those kelpy beaches are actually a sign of a really healthy marine environment. And for years, when the El Nino storms had come through, a lot of those kelp beds went away to both do the rough surf and the higher temperatures of the water. Well, they're back now, and the fisheries are restarting, and it's a good sign all the way around. The water's heavily oxygenated, so which means you can't see through it, so it's not all pretty and opaque and blue like you like in the tropics. But once again, we've got some amazing marine life here. And looking back on the city, you can see why the first explorers that came here and you know, people like Richard Henry Dana and traders and explorers found this so attractive. It doesn't have a natural cove or anchorage, which is why this breakwater got built here, part by Max Fleischmann of the famous Fleischmann Yeats fortune, in cooperation with the city. Harvard has said this stone that's on the breakwater from Fry's Harbor over in Santa Cruz and built this breakwater so Max could have his boat there. And he wanted his boat downtown. There were probably a couple of locations that geologically would have been better off, but this is where Max wanted it, so this is where the city fathers put it.
So Randy, why are you running?
Well, I'll tell you, Larry, I'm running because when I got on council last December as an appointee, I found that number one, I enjoyed the work. Number two, I was actually more passionate about some of the issues in the city than I even imagined I was going to be. And I also really enjoy the work that I'm doing with my colleagues. I think we've got a really good team. I think we're moving forward on a lot of issues financially. We're moving on forward on issues on safety and security, things that were trending the way they probably shouldn't have trended over the last decade or so. And now I think we've kind of started to reverse that course, and things are looking better, and Santa Barbara's looking better. And I really do look forward to a real bright and vital future, and I like to be a part of that. So Yeah, being a candidate, being a campaigner, yeah, I can't say that's my favorite thing in the world. I'm not a politician. Never wanted to be, never will be. But as a businessman and hopefully part-time sailor, I have to say that I really enjoy being a part of Santa Barbara. And Santa Barbara, I think, is it's just kind of in my blood, and that's what I'd like to do. I'd like to be a part of this city, and I'd like to be a part of her future, because I think it's a bright one, and I really do think we're moving in the right direction.
Okay, well, good luck to you, Randy.
Hey, thanks, Larry. Appreciate it. Hope you enjoyed the sail.
You're watching Touring with the Candidates for Santa Barbara City Council. Let's watch the next candidate.
Well, hello there. And you are?
I'm Ia Falcone, and I'm again running for City Council. Please, come in.
Well, thanks for having me over
sure.
today. I'll let you go first.
Okay. Welcome. It's the kitchen.
Okay. Lovely old home.
And here's the main part of the home. Notice the high vaulted ceilings. This house is from 1926. It was originally moved here from Delavina Street. And we've added on to it over the years and been very comfortable here for the past almost 20 years.
What part of town are we in?
We're on the Mesa. We are on the Great Mesa of Santa Barbara, one of the great neighborhoods, along with, you know, we have so many wonderful neighborhoods. But Larry, if I could, now I'd really like to take you and show you some of my favorite things.
Okay, well, I'll follow along.
Okay, thank you. Oh, before we leave, would you mind if I introduce you to my precious puppies?
Oh, sure. Who do we have here?
We have JJ. Come here, puppy. Come on, baby. Oh, he's shy. He's camera shy, you see? And then this is Samantha, who's
Samantha.
Preoccupied with her very favorite activity, which is gnawing on a bone. The only thing she likes better is running on the beach, and we're going to show you that beach in just a little while.
Okay,
so,
thank you.
What you're looking at right now is Cliff Drive, which we just recently restriped to two lanes, put in a very visible bike lane, and made this more of a neighborhood street. It's the beginning of what we hope will be more enhancements for the neighborhood of the Mesa, which is our main street. So we're very proud of that. Our next destination is going to be the Arroyo Burro Creek and Estuary Restoration. We're now in the Arroyo Burro Estuary Restoration, and you can see from what it used to be to what it is now. It's a gorgeous path of native plants, all funded by the Creeks Committee money. Well, over here, you'll see that this cement and revetments and all these various terrible things have all been taken out. The creek flow has been restored. The lagoon flow is no longer polluted. And you can see the beautiful restoration. And finally, on this same path, now you can cross this bridge that the city put in and go all the way up to the Wilcox property, which is Off-Leash Dog. And I'm going to take you to the beach, Off-Leash Dog area.
Okay.
So now we are at the Off-Leash Dog Park area that I'm very proud of, fought very hard for, and it's right at the base of the Wilcox property, better known as the Douglas Family Preserve now. We were just on the other side of it. But you can see the dogs playing. It's a weekday that we're doing this, so not too many dogs, but you should come here on a weekend, and boy, there's happy, happy puppies. Turn around, you'll see two more that are coming to play. And now we are at the corner of Quarantina and Mason Street at what I refer to as the Big House, or the major recycling center of Santa Barbara. We took our recycling from 34% to 74% in the 8 years that I was on council. Anybody can bring whatever you want here, and they will do their best to recycle it, from old mattresses to wood, construction, demolition. It's really a fantastic facility, and it's helped us get a hold of our trash problem.
What part of town are we in here?
We are in the industrial zone, and you can see all these big trucks going by. We're at the 101 Quarantina and Mason Street. Now we're at the other end of the building, and it's just a hubbub of activity. You can see all the trucks in the background sorting various different kinds of recyclable materials. And up above, you can see where the line the folks up there are actually sorting through trash to put in one pile or another. This is a tremendous facility and goes a long way to keeping things out of the Tahiguas landfill. Here now, we're on Calle Cesar Chavez, right across the street from the Casa de la Raza. And this is a very interesting project. When you talk about workforce housing and middle-income housing, here's a great example. These condos are for sale, but they're all in the middle-income range. So, if you would like to be able to stay in Santa Barbara and be close to where you work, we're trying to achieve that through projects like that. It's not all going to be high-rise buildings. So now here we are at the Teen Center. And when this building became available, the staff actually wanted to turn it into office buildings. But the Youth Council came to us and said, please save this building for us. We don't have a teen center and we really could use one. So I thought it was a brilliant idea, and here it is.
Where are we at here?
We're on the corner of Chapala and Victoria Street, right in downtown Santa Barbara. The Teen Center is incredibly important and is now the home to PAL, the Police Activities League, which is an organization that was started about 7 years ago, and now the city does help to fund it. They serve about 1,500 at-risk youth and low-income youth every year, and it's incredibly important, the connection that is made between the youth, the law enforcement, to give our kids a chance at something as an alternative to gangs.
Ia, you were telling me about how you help bring different agencies together. Tell me about that.
Well, when we started really seeing the gang research, and partly because the police numbers had been diminished, the gangs came back. And the problem with that is that all the agencies that are out there, the nonprofits, the governmental agencies, the county, the school districts, City College, UCSB, they weren't really working together. And so I helped to put together a group that really work together. It's called the South Coast Youth Gang Task Force, and it's up and running now, and there's much more collaboration between these organizations that deal with our young people to train them and to get them into skills so that they have hope for the future and are able to support their families into the future, and that there are alternatives to gangs, and good jobs is one of those. This is an incredibly important endeavor that everybody, the grown-ups in the situation, really are able to work together. The future of our youth really depend on it. This is an incredibly important place, an incredibly important project, and I am committed to seeing it into the future. Now and finally, we are at the harbor, which to me is Santa Barbara's playground, and I think for a lot of other people. Most importantly, this is a working harbor. This is a very picturesque microcosm of the city. There are people who live here, there are people who work here, there are people who own businesses, and there are people who play here. One of the main features here, however, is the working fleet of fishing boats that we have. It's really important. These folks are multi-generational, many of them, and they make their living still on the sea. We need to keep the harbor open, so we ask the federal government every year for upwards of $1 million to keep this harbor open so that not only our fishing fleet can come and go, but also the Coast Guard Blackfin, which is stationed here as well. This is a very hard-working, wonderful place that we have finally been able to connect to the tourist destination of Stearns Wharf through all the new accoutrements that are on Cabrillo Boulevard, connecting the West Beach area and the tourist area of Stearns Wharf to this fabulous working harbor, which is one of the lifebloods of Santa Barbara. So I'm very happy to be here showing this to you today, and thank you very much for all of your time and taking this journey with me. I appreciate it, Larry, very much, and I do hope I've earned your vote on November 8th.
Okay, well, thank you, Ia. Good luck to you.
Thank you so much.
You are watching Touring with the Candidates, brought to you by the League of Women Voters of Santa Barbara. Let's look at the next candidate.
There's your signs for
well,
today.
Well, hello there.
Hi, Larry.
And you are?
I'm Kathy Murillo. I'm a candidate for Santa Barbara City Council.
Nice to see you today.
Thank you. This is my friend and neighbor, Sue LaFond.
Hi, Sue.
And she's helping with signs today. And we need to let Kristen and Roxy through.
Okay.
Kristen is also a helper. And this is my dog, Roxy. She's walking her.
Hi, Roxy.
Roxy's a 10-year-old rescue, and she's a bull terrier. Thanks, Kristen. So, Larry, can we go to my front yard? I think the lighting's better out there.
Okay, will do.
First of all, I'd like to thank the League of Women Voters for this opportunity to speak directly to the voters of Santa Barbara. My name is Kathy Murillo. I'm inspired to participate in the political process as a candidate. And just a little bit about myself, I came to Santa Barbara when I was 17 to go to UCSB. And I've graduated with a degree in dramatic art. And I step up with experience as a journalist and a youth advocate. And I think my journalism experience is a great background for public service. I understand local government, budget and finance, environmental and social issues, and journalism has also taught me how to build trust with people, how to ask tough questions. I know how to research and analyze and seek and respect diverse opinions.
You know, I always enjoyed reading your columns when you were in the Independent.
Thank you so much. I've worked for the Santa Barbara Independent. I lived for 3 years in Ventura County, and Larry, there I worked for the Los Angeles Times and the Ventura County Star. But I also have extensive youth development experience. I've taught theater arts to elementary school children. I've mentored at-risk teens, and now I work at KCSB Radio, where I teach college students broadcast journalism, communication skills, and media literacy. But let's go to our next stop.
Okay.
Thank you. Hi, everybody. This is Cesar Trujillo. He's my friend who lives here in the Bungalow Haven area. And behind us is the construction site. It used to be St. Francis Hospital. Cesar and I are sad that St. Francis is gone. We were hoping for a competition with hospitals, and a lot of people had babies there. And I just want the voters to know that I'm the kind of candidate that would care about large and small construction projects having impacts in a neighborhood. But we have other things in common. We're both advocates for the youth of Santa Barbara, and we're both working on a voter registration drive in this election. So Cesar, I know you care a lot about community policing. I'm an advocate for that too. Our police force needs to have positive relationships with all our youth, but especially our Latino youth.
Yes, we need to have a better connection and relationship between our youth and the police. I think is very important.
And you and I have talked about the PAL program. It's a police-sponsored program, and it's well-funded. And it helps young people find opportunities for after-school programming and summer camps. And Cesar's also very concerned about voter registration. We want to invigorate the Latino community, right?
Next year is the Raza. The Raza needs to come out and vote. 2012. Where the Mayan calendar dictates that we come out and vote, so.
Okay.
Thanks, Cesar. Well, and then we have a voter registration event scheduled for October 8th, Saturday, October 8th, and I'll tell the viewers more about that at the end of our program. Thank you, Cesar.
Thank you.
This is where I take the bus. I live on the west side and I commute by the number 24 Express to UC Santa Barbara. I have a car, but I try to use public transit as much as possible. I'm an advocate for transportation alternatives, bike lanes, commuter rail. I'm hoping we can get more people coming from Ventura or Lompoc through trains. And I would also like to represent the interests of people who ride the bus, people who are renters. I'm a renter. I use our public parks for recreation. I think there's a lot of working people like myself who need municipal services because of who they are and how they live. And then finally, Larry, over here is Mission Creek, and I just want people to know that I care very much about creeks restoration, clean and healthy beaches, The steelhead trout, they're an endangered fish, anadromous fish, meaning that they live in the ocean and they swim back up. Mission Creek to make babies, so to speak, to spawn. And there's projects underway to help them get up there when it's their season. And I think that if we have healthy creeks, it's also a tourism draw, because when I visit other towns, I go to parks and creeks, and I want to see natural attractions. Okay, and on to our next stop. We're here at Douglas Family Preserve, and I got married here around those trees over there. And that's why I'm an advocate for restoring our parks funding, because people like myself need and use our parks for special occasions, for recreation. People who live in apartment houses, they don't have a backyard, and so that's why the public parks are so important to them. And I'm also a supporter of off-leash dog recreation, and I have an idea of establishing an enclosed off-leash dog facility, not here at Douglas Family Preserve, because this is meant to be an open space. But another city park, I want to work with staff to find another one. There might be private funding. There's a lot of animal welfare, animal recreation, people who might fund such an enclosure. They're very popular in Goleta, like Tabano Hollow. People in Santa Barbara will drive from there, you know, just for that enclosure. So again, not at Douglas Family Preserve, but somewhere else. And I have also done some community service here. I helped take out some weeds in this area over here one day, and it was hard work, but that is one of the things that I've done in terms of community service. This is Garden Court. It's a housing complex for senior citizens. My friend Tammy's mom lives here. Hello, Charlene. I'd like people to know that I'm an advocate for our senior citizens. I turned 50 this year. There's a lot of baby boomers who are aging, and the city of Santa Barbara needs to be responsive to that population with recreation services, public safety concerns. We want everyone to feel safe and comfortable in their homes and on the streets. This is also a dangerous intersection down here, Figueroa and Delavina, and city staff working right now on how to reconfigure that or put crosswalks or other improvements to make it safe for people who are walking. In terms of housing in general, this is well-designed, compact housing in the downtown area. That's what I advocate for right now in our general plan. We're making accommodation for mixed-use housing. That means commercial on the bottom and rental or condominiums on top or in the back. As part of the general plan, we have accommodations for that in the downtown area and Upper State Street. And I think we can do that without changing the historic character of Santa Barbara. That's what a lot of people are concerned about. And I would support projects that give us housing but don't impact our historic resources. I wanted the Eastside Library to be our final stop because I'm an advocate for restoring funding for our libraries, our parks and our recreation services to serve our youth population. I spent a lot of afternoons in the public libraries as a child. I grew up in East Los Angeles. My father was in a gang, and I survived the gang culture by connecting to our libraries, to my school. I stayed in school, I got scholarships, and I graduated from UC Santa Barbara. I'm a role model for our young people, and I want them to know they don't have to repeat the mistakes of their parents. In closing, I'd like to be an ambassador for the city of Santa Barbara, an ambassador for our arts community, for our nonprofits, for the business community, for individual businesses. I consider every resident in Santa Barbara my neighbor. I care about your neighborhood, your family, your prosperity, and your safety. I ask for your vote.
Okay, well, good luck to you, Kathy.
Thank you very much.
You're watching Touring with the Candidates for Santa Barbara City Council. I'm the filmmaker, Larry Nimmer. Well, hello there.
How's it going, Larry?
Good, and you are?
My name is Crucito Herrera Cruz, and I'm running for Santa Barbara City Council.
Well, thank you for having us.
Welcome in. Remember that tree trunk I had?
On your last tour, right?
Yes. Yeah. Now it's a beautiful drum for Danza Azteca, so I want to see the show Santa Barbarians that it's a drum, and it goes a little something like this. Dulce madre mía, como tú lo ves, canto mi alegría postrado a tus pies. Dulce madre mía, como tú lo ves, canto mi alegría postrado a tus pies. Hey.
Very nice.
Oh, Mateo.
So, Cruzito, where are we now?
Well, we find ourselves here located at Santa Barbara Courthouse Law Library. My name is Cruzito Herrera Cruz, and the reason I'm running for Santa Barbara City Council and for the voters to go out and vote for Cruzito Herrera Cruz November 8th is for the reason that I believe that all Santa Barbarians should respect democratic principles and the idea of equalitarianism, where everybody in Santa Barbara, all Santa Barbarians, should be treated equally under the law and under this Constitution. The Constitution Article 2 of Section 1 says, all political power is inherent in the people. Government is instituted for the protection, security, and benefit, and they have the right to alter or reform it when the public good may require it. I think if we look at it and look at the polity at this moment, there's an over-representation of one community and no representation of the particular community that I would like to strive for to represent. Well, Larry, we're here at the Law Library, and why this document is so important, the Constitution of the United States and the 14th Amendment of the Equal Protection Clause, is that the political minority in our community's right to vote in the Santa Barbara City Council race is unconstitutionally impaired. We are at a standstill of having no representation, so be it that we live in an at-large district and the vote dilution happens, the interjection that district-based elections would basically allow us an opportunity to have some form of representation under the Elections Code, California Votes Writings Acts of 2001.
Currently, are there any Latino city council people?
There is zero candidates of Latino descent or Mexican-American culture. No Americans that are of that ethnicity. The California Votes Writings Act of 2001, located in Elections Code 14025, states that a political minority cannot or does not have political remedies for issues, and this is why it's important, which while I'll address in a couple minutes. But why? Because of the future implementation of policies that benefit the public and the public welfare fail to exist or fail to be implemented or initiated by the past predecessors. We look at Elections Code 14026 under district-based elections is very important. And why district-based elections is important? Because voters get the ability to choose who their representative is, give them the determination and the power to elect their representative, and that representative is going to be accountable and have some form of transparency to their voting constituents within their respective political districts. What we're looking at here is the Redevelopment Agency of the City of Santa Barbara, history of tax increment revenues. We look at 1977, which basically pulled in $747,560,000. We're going to estimate all the way to 2019 what we're going to be generating if we look at it. That's $453,949,472. What that money basically reflects is 30 years of Santa Barbarians investing in that tax community and generating commerce, generating business. So I want to thank you for creating that economic engine. We focused all our attention in this corridor, which is the Santa Barbara Central City Redevelopment Project area, since the 1970s to the present day. In about a couple years, the redevelopment community law is going to be expiring, and future city council members are going to have to take leadership. They're going to have to make characteristics that show that the West Side community has conditions of blighted areas. It's predominantly urbanized. It constitutes possibly serious
physical and economic burdens on its residents and on the youth. We look at the conditions on the Milpas area. There's physical and economic blight under health and safety codes 33,031. Some buildings are unsafe. There's conditions that we need to prevent. For example, economic conditions that cause blight, depreciated property values, abnormal high business vacancies, which we have on the Milpas corridor. We have serious residential overcrowding, which is a significant public health and safety concern. Overcrowding under California codes of regulations is important because of the lack of equitable housing or low-income housing being built by the city, and none of our leadership presently has taken the stance to build such policies for residents that are hardworking. We look at excess bars in this community, a high crime rate on the Milpas area. These are all conditions of blighted areas under health and safety code, and this is why it's important for the future city council to rehabilitate our communities now that we have rehabilitated the business community for tourism dollar. Now let's invest into our neighborhood. What you see here is the original city clerk's filing of the City of Santa Barbara's gang injunction, March 14, 2011, case number 1379826. I definitely have a couple concerns against this document and the policies and the unconstitutionality of what it's going to cause in the future and the taxpayers' cost also. Well, what you have here is the actual safety zones of Santa Barbara if a gang injunction would be held over by the court. Yeah, Larry, and so coming back to the idea of a gang injunction that is not merited nor legally needed in this community, what happens here is this community is going to be inundated once again with more police enforcement and harassment, and also on the Milpas area, where in Health and Safety Code it specifically states that we cannot police our way out of a social service problem in our community. And if we look at the budget of the city, we're going to see is that it's going to be top heavy, and let me just make a reference to that right now. And so what the problem is with such measures that we have is that this whole yellow pie chart is related to 32.7 to police, and criticizing the budget allotments is something that we have to take leadership and really focus on developing and instilling more percentage in the community development grant, more for the fire department, more for parks and recreation, because this is important. This is where our youth activities is coming. We need to invest more money in the parks and recreations, and also we need to have the infrastructure within our city of public works also increased and reprioritize our budget. Thank you, Larry. Well, in wrapping up and a summary of what we talked about, we definitely want district-based elections under 14,026-3B Elections Code. We also would like a new community redevelopment law and rehabilitating and revitalizing the West Side, East Side community as law. And we also would not like a gang injunction. So on the legal merits of the unconstitutionality of all those principles, the lack of representation, we need to get involved, get engaged. Vote for Cruzito Herrera Cruz on November 8th or mail your ballot in. Thank you, Larry Nimber. Thank you, the Women's of League of Women's Voter. Gracias, Ama.
Good luck to you, Cruzito.
Thank you. Oh, Mateo.
The itinerary and commentary included is up to each candidate. The program is filmed and produced by Larry Nimmer.
Well, hi, and you are?
I'm City Councilman Dale Francisco, running for re-election this year.
Nice to see you, Dale.
Good to see you, Larry.
What are we talking about today?
Well, here at City Hall, I just got out of a meeting. I'm on the Solid Waste Subcommittee, Ad Hoc Committee, to talk about who's going to be our next trash hauler for one half of the city. But if you're on City Council, you do lots of things. And one thing I'd like to talk about today is the budget. Uh-huh. This handy chart here shows a very interesting progression over time. This yellow bar shows the amount of fiscal reserves we had for the general fund. That's our rainy day fund, the money that we use in case there's an economic downturn to shore up city services. And as you can see, We had revenue increasing until the year 2008. That's when the recession really hit Santa Barbara and we started heading downhill. Unfortunately, our reserve fund was being used at the same time, and here in 2008 you can see it was diminished almost to nothing. I'm happy to say that since that time, that was the first year I was on council. I'm not saying that I personally did this. This is the result of a lot of hard work by city staff and council. We've been slowly increasing the reserves, and this year we're starting to see an increase in sales tax and other revenues. And I'm also very happy to say that because of the hard work of a lot of people at the city, we actually came in $2 million under budget this year. So that money will also be going back into the reserves. So we're in a healthier financial position than we've been for a while.
Dale, what does the financial future look like for the city?
Larry, that's a good question. Hard to say. We've seen increases in some of our revenue, but the economy overall, the national economy, the state economy, is still very uncertain. And I'm glad that we were able to work with the city's various labor unions this year. They gave up some money, and I think it's prudent to go forward that way. We just don't know what's going to happen this coming year.
Okay, Dale, where are we now?
We're in front of Casa Esperanza, the homeless shelter on Cacique Street. And the reason I came here is because homelessness, which is kind of a vague term, that's one of the big problems that the city has faced for quite a while. And I believe that what we've done in the past hasn't worked and we need to change our approach. I'm chairman of the Council Subcommittee on Homelessness, and we are taking a new approach. We're going to talk more about this over at the police department, but one of the things that we've done this year is to actually hire more officers, and one of those officers is going to be what's called a restorative police officer who works directly with the homeless, just focused on the homeless, and with the aid of outreach workers who we've also hired to work with the police. They work to get people off the street and into treatment, whether it's at a homeless shelter or getting them connected, reconnected with their family, wherever their family may be. So the restorative program is very important. The other thing that we're going to do is, as a result of the committee's work, we're going to establish a joint committee of city and council, city council and county government elected officials to set policy for the long run on the homeless problem. You've got all kinds of different people. Unfortunately, we have a lot of mentally ill people on the street who should be institutionalized. That's a state level problem that we can't do a lot about, but we can work with the county. This county is responsible for mental health services. There are also things that we can do for other folks to get them off the street and into a better situation. There's a lot of folks out here with serious drug and alcohol addictions. That's how a lot of people end up living under bridges. And it's a problem that we're just going to have to confront in a different way.
Dale, what do you think about this location here on Lower Milpus?
I think, Larry, what we've learned over the years is that this was probably not the best site. The level of crime in the neighborhood has gone up enormously. It's been a burden on the neighborhood. And it's not great for the people who live here either, because there are, frankly, a lot of liquor stores around here. So I think in the long run, we're going to have to find a better location for Casa Esperanza.
Okay, go ahead, Dale.
All right, Larry, we're here at the police department on Figueroa Street. And I wanted to talk about something that I'm really most proud of. This year, for the first time in 10 years, the City Council voted to actually increase the number of police officers. We were at 137. That was the police force, the number of officers. We have civilians working for the police department too, of course. We increased it in this year's budget to 141. Now that may sound small, just four more officers, but if we keep doing that over the next few years, eventually we'll get back to the strength that I think we need to be. 10 years ago, the police department in Santa Barbara had 150 sworn officers, and we need to get back to that.
What is the difference of having them actually on the street? Does it make a big difference?
It makes a huge difference. When people see police officers on the street, when you have officers who can really be beat cops and know the people in the community, know the business owners, it makes a huge difference. A lot of bad behavior just doesn't happen if there's a police officer around. Larry, one thing I'd like to mention is that in this year's election, the Police Officers Association, the police union, has decided not to endorse me, and I understand that. the police have the hardest job in the city. I couldn't do it. And they're out there putting their lives on the line every day. And I really, really appreciate it. And there's great people working for the police department. But we had to ask for concessions this year at labor negotiations. There was just no way around it. And I know there are some people in the leadership of the Police Officers Association who feel differently about that. But I've looked at the budget, and I just think we've got 86% of the police department budget is wages and benefits. And there was simply no way to get to a balanced budget without some concessions. And I'm glad that the Police Officers Association ultimately did come around and help us out this year. Larry, here we are at the Kachuma Operations and Maintenance Board in the hills above San Roque. One of the privileges I have on City Council is representing the city on various regional boards, and this is a really important one. The Kachuma Operations and Maintenance Board, or COAM, is responsible for operating Lake Kachuma, as well as the South Coast Conduit that brings water through the mountains, along the foothills, all the way from Goleta to Carpinteria, supplying 80% roughly of the South Coast's water supply. This is an absolutely vital program that most people don't even know exists. We recently hired, I'm happy to say, I was on the executive search committee, we recently hired a new general manager, Bruce Mowry, who has 30 years of experience in civil engineering. And we really need someone like Bruce because this project is 60 years old and we've got some decaying infrastructure. We're going to have to replace major parts of the South Coast Conduit, and it's great having someone like Bruce on board to help us make the right decisions. Here we are above the city at Franceschi Park.
Dale, tell me, what's it been like serving the last 4 years?
It's been great. This has been one of the most interesting and enjoyable jobs I've ever had. I've lived in Santa Barbara for 30 years, and I care a lot about this city. One of the most beautiful places in the world, no question about it. And we have our problems, like everywhere, but it's been a privilege for me to represent the people of Santa Barbara and to try to understand those problems and come up with good solutions.
Well, very good. Do you want to give any contact information, like
sure,
a website?
Sure, absolutely. People can go to my website, which is dalefrancisco.com.
Okay, well, good luck to you, Dale.
Thanks, Larry. It's been a pleasure.
You're watching Touring with the Candidates for Santa Barbara City Council. I'm the film producer, Larry Nimmer. Let's watch the next candidate. Well, hello there.
Hey, how we doing?
Good, and you are?
I'm Sebastian Aldana, and I'm running for Santa Barbara City Council.
Nice to see you. Thanks for having me.
Come on in.
Okay, great. Let's see. I see you have some photos here. Who's this?
It's Sebastian Sr., my mother Maria, and family.
Nice.
Some of the grandkids.
Nice. And let's see what else we have here.
Yeah, I just wanted to point out one thing. When I get involved, you know, here's when I was shooting pool, but then I'd be the top shooter, you know, of the team. So it's just, I always strive for excellence.
Nice.
I got involved with the Moose Lodge for a few years, and I turned out to be Moose of the Year.
Huh.
And then I got involved with the Looking Good Santa Barbara with the graffiti and litter abatement, and I was awarded a 2009 Spirit of Service for the Outstanding Neighbor. That's just the way I am. When I get involved, I get in there, get things done.
Nice.
So, and I want to take that to City Hall and just hit it hard.
Nice. And you have some photos on the wall here, right?
Yeah, here's some more pictures of the family.
Okay.
We got a young Sebastian there.
Oh, this is you in your younger years?
Yeah.
And with your wife?
Uh-huh.
Very good. Beautiful picture.
That's before my gray hair. All right, Larry, let's take our tour.
Okay.
Let's go. Oh, here's one more thing. It says, Buenvenidos. Mi casa es mi casa. So, well, a friend of mine gave it to me, and he just knows the way I am. So.
Okay, let's go.
Okay, let's do it. Okay, we're going to go to the Franklin Center. I was part of the Franklin Advisory Committee, and I'd just like to let you know where some of my activism started.
Okay, Sebastian, where are we?
Yeah, we're at the Franklin Neighborhood Center, and this is the advisory committee that I belonged to for about 3 years. Now it's a neighborhood advisory council.
And what type of work do you do here?
It's just hearing the neighborhood's needs and concerns, and then just dealing with it, just taking it to the right department to fix the, resolve the problem.
What type of problems are there?
Oh, it could be sidewalk repair, it could be curb cuts, it could be lighting. There's a lot of lighting problems, could be tree trimming. Just typical neighborhood issues.
Okay.
Okay, now we're in the kitchen at the Franklin Center, and the Franklin Advisory Committee went up to bat to get the funding, the CDBG funding for the center. It was right about $125,000, and with this renovation, it's in process for some seniors to feed the seniors. The program's in process, and then also another program to teach kids culinary arts.
What part of town are we in here?
East Side. Santa Barbara's beautiful East Side.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, now we're at the new drop-in center at the Franklin Center. And as you can see, we got a pool table for the kids, a foosball, got music, Xbox, and then over here we got the computers. Once again, here's the computers. And this was another CDBG-funded project that we went up to bat for. It was right about $25,000 for the new drop-in center.
So, Sebastian, any thoughts what can be done about the gang problem?
Well, it's always good to, just like where we came from for the drop-in center, find ways to keep the youth busy. But going by the stats of the police, the ones I've seen, less than 1%, 0.77% is gang-related problem. You know, back in a couple years ago, they had the Gator Roll. They took about 120 gang members away. So, yes, we have issues. Yes, there are incidents, but it's 0.77 of a problem. We got 99% of something else. I like to get a pie sheet, a pie chart, I should say, and find out what's that other 99%,
Okay, and where are we now?
Okay, now we're at the corner of Aliso's and Yalanali. On this corner right here, there was only one curb cut. There was only one. That's the existing one. But we went up to bat and got more CDBG funding. I believe it was right about $80,000 or so. But from Carpinteria to Ortega, we now have, every corner has a curb cut. So wherever there wasn't a curb cut, we have it now. And it's needed for the young families, for the moms. Right here we have a lady coming from the supermarket. And in this area, some people are going to the laundromat. They have their baskets full of laundry to go use the laundromat. So this was a much needed improvement.
Sebastian, what do you do for a living?
Well, I've been a painter by trade, a journeyman painter for 30 years, but I'm in transition right now. I'm hanging up my brushes and picking up a spatula.
Oh, that's
so. Yeah, so right here, here's an advertisement. They got Los Amigos Cafe. I'm right there at 601 East Montecito Street. It's Sundays only. There's a big pot of menudo. So menudo on the weekends and politics during the week.
That's good.
And tri-tip on Fridays.
Aren't you in another place in that paper too?
Yeah. They put made a little article. So there it is in English, Spanish. There was a little interview, and this is with the Santa Barbara Latino. Okay, we're right here at Milpas and Carpinteria at the exit. This is another problem we have right here in our neighborhood, is the encampment. The way this landscape is, we got to do some trimming. Caltrans did trim up the palm trees, but it's a big problem because they gather here, they drink, they use drugs, and then from there they carry on into the neighborhood. And this is something that I've been working on for a while. I was able to get a no trespassing, but as you can see, people don't obey it.
Go ahead.
Okay, there's another area that we need to clean up a little bit. You know, this is where on Cacique and Milpas, and I just don't feel that this is fair for the neighborhood. This is our gateway to the neighborhood, and this is what we get.
Sebastian, where are we now?
Okay, we're at the Cabrillo Ball Field. Right here, we're at the dugouts, and this is one more project that the Franklin Advisory Committee went up to bat for, $25,000. And what we did was we fenced in the dugouts. There was a big problem with people hanging out here and drinking and using drugs and just making a mess. And then when the ball people came to play ball, they came to a mess. So now the city cleans it up. When they come to play ball, they have a clean environment. And it really made a big improvement. Okay, so you saw some of the improvements that I was part of. I'm co-founder and VP of the Milpas Community Association for that reason also. It's about public health and safety and improvements, making it safe for everybody. But we also need to deal with real homeless solutions. It's very important. Youth, we got to deal with our youth. Re-greening, I think we've got to keep the place clean. And then also low housing, affordable housing. We've got to make it, you know, fair for everybody to live here. I was born here. I appreciate your vote. I want to be part of making the decisions. Please vote for me, Sebastian Aldana.
Okay, well, good luck to you, Sebastian.
Gracias.
You are watching Touring with the Candidates for Santa Barbara City Council, brought to you by the League of Women Voters of Santa Barbara. Let's look at the next candidate.
Well, hello.
Hi, Larry.
And you are?
My name is Deborah Schwartz, and I'm a candidate running for Santa Barbara City Council this year. Come on into our home.
Well, thank you very much. Looks like you have a lovely place.
Thank you, Larry.
So, you live here with?
I live here with my partner, Hap Ziegler. And what's so comfortable for us, Larry, is that this really epitomizes Santa Barbara's sort of indoor-outdoor year-round living and lifestyle. And we love to have friends and family and colleagues over, socialize, barbecue. And we're just so happy to be here in the downtown area. As you know, Cottage Hospital is nearby. And
right
we think
around
it's
the corner.
Right around the corner. And we think it's a wonderful neighborhood and a wonderful location for us.
Okay, well, should we hit the road?
Let's do that.
Okay, go ahead.
Larry, we're passing one of my favorite neighborhood eateries, Los Gallos. And then right here is one of my favorite neighborhood cafes, The Daily Grind. And this is one of nine neighborhoods I've lived in since.
How many?
Nine. Since moving to Santa Barbara in 1967. Seven of the nine are right here in the city. Larry, to the left of us is a property that the Planning Commission and I as a Planning Commissioner just visited this morning. This is the site of a proposed new memory care facility, and we're so in need of these sorts of facilities in Santa Barbara. There's a wait list, so I'm very much looking forward to this project coming before the Commission this Thursday. Larry, we're coming up on Garden Court, which is a Housing Authority City of Santa Barbara low-income senior project, and I'm so proud as a Planning Commissioner to be one of the strongest champions of both affordable housing as well as much-needed housing for our seniors. We're in the West Downtown neighborhood, Larry, and right behind me is an example of an infill project that I'm very pleased to have been a part of approving as a planning commissioner. We only have 10% of real estate available left in Santa Barbara for any type of development, whether it's infill or redevelopment or new development. And this is going to be a live-work project where those who own a residential units on the top will also have an opportunity to have their business down below. So you see broken asphalt. It's not a very attractive looking area now. This is really going to beautify and revitalize the neighborhood in the West Downtown area. And Larry, just down the street on De La Vina, the corner of De La Guerra, we have the headquarters for Melchiori Construction. Here's an example where Melchiori was forward-thinking, and they acquired nearby residential properties for their employees. So here's an example of workforce housing, because they realize that it's very important to have as many of their workers living as close to where they work as possible. Larry, we're here down at the harbor, and this is one of my most special areas of town. We have the Maritime Museum, we have wonderful restaurants, a thriving commercial fishing enterprise down here, a place for both locals and visitors to come and enjoy. And for me, it's a special part of my upbringing because as a teenager and during the summers, I participated in Santa Barbara Aquatic Association. And it was really at that point in my life that I began to truly appreciate the importance of our marine environment. And over the years, how fragile and how important our environment is for protection. And that's another part of my campaign platform and one in which I hope to carry into policy making as a council member. We're here at one of my alma maters, Santa Barbara Junior High, and you can tell by the beautiful architectural design. It is a city historic landmark, that it's a very special place. For me, I had three wonderful years here, and since I graduated from junior high, a group of concerned and very forward-thinking residents, including my former colleague Rod Latham, came together to raise the money and restore our auditorium, now called the Marjorie Luke Theater, which is a wonderful community resource and really a pride and joy for everybody to participate in.
And go ahead.
We're here in the Haley Gutierrez neighborhood. Larry, and one of my favorite family-owned restaurants in this area is Rose Cafe. Of course, they have another location up on the Mesa. One of our thriving businesses, Larry, that has expanded in Santa Barbara, and it's really a homegrown business, is Michael Crandell's Right Scale. They're taking over this entire building at 402 East Gutierrez. Good paying jobs, a local employer. This is the kind of business that we need to reach out to and support. What people love about this area are the mom and pop businesses, and one of the new businesses in this area of Milpas, Larry, is Allen Associates. They have invested in being here long term. This is a renovated, sustainable building that is their business, a sustainable green building, and I think it's terrific that a founder, a CEO like Dennis Allen, with an employee-owned business, has made a significant investment in staying on Milpas and in contributing to its vitality.
Okay, where are we here?
So we're in the East Side neighborhood, and this is Adelante Charter School here, and we're right near the Franklin Center and the East Side Library.
Go ahead.
We're here at the East Side Branch Library, Larry, which is one of our most important library branches in Santa Barbara. So many of our young children leaving school on their way home, they need a safe and nurturing place to come. And it's been a real tragedy that on Monday afternoons, that library has been closed due to funding. So one of my priorities as a future city council member is going to be to ensure that we allocate the proper funds to have that library open for maximum days and hours.
Okay, we're looking at some of the businesses on State Street. Now, your background's in business, right?
That's right, Larry. In my 20 years in San Francisco before I moved back to Santa Barbara, I was in the fields of public relations and marketing, and then ultimately was a director for AT&T, and I feel that those skill sets and experiences I've built in both small and large businesses have really given me an ability to understand fiscal management, and I'm ready to hit the ground running should the voters support me becoming one of their next city council members. You can see here on State Street, businesses are critical to the economic vitality of Santa Barbara. It's special to me that we're winding up our tour together, Larry, here in front of the Naomi Schwartz County Office Building. My mother, Naomi, who was the first district supervisor for 12 years, has been a guiding source of inspiration and support my entire life. And I really learned firsthand from her the honor and importance of public service. And from my father, Arthur Schwartz, who was until recently a longtime professor at UCSB, from him his passion for and commitment to educating and inspiring our youth have both brought me here today running for city council, and I hope those who are watching and would like to learn more about me and get involved in the campaign can go to www.schwartzforcitycouncil.com. Thank you.
Okay, well, good luck to you, Deborah.
You have been watching Touring with the Candidates, brought to you by the League of Women Voters of Santa Barbara and produced by Larry Nimmer. In addition to programs like this, we sponsor forums and we also offer information online at our website, www.smartvoter.org. We also invite candidates to post their information on that website. We hope you've enjoyed our program and remember to vote. For the League of Women Voters of Santa Barbara, I'm Irene Stone, and we look forward to seeing you next time.